Good morning, Northgate. Come on, can you stand to your feet? We're gonna get into some worship this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We're gonna rejoice and be glad in it. Happy New Year. We're so glad you're here with us today. Come on, put those hands together like this. Here we go. Sing this out. Sing. Yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. Oh, he's carrying our burdens. Come on, say, say, he has overcome. Yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken. So grateful for who you are. The song simply says that God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness. He's lighting up the kingdom in the name of Jesus. We're gonna shout that out and sing that together. Here we go. This is God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy's defeated, and we will shout it. May be seated in this moment.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Go ahead and take a seat. My name is Vanessa. I'm on staff here at Northgate, and I just want to tell you all, Happy New Year and welcome back. Welcome back, everybody. So you are joining us in the room or you are online, and there are a couple of resources that we want to make sure we get into your hands today. So if you're in the room, in front of you, you see something like this, a little card. It's sticking out of the chair in front of you. These are our connection cards, and it's how we connect with you. And if it's your first time, second time, or third time with us here in the room, or maybe you've never let us know that you're here in the first place, but you've been here for 6 months, take that card out, fill it out, and bring it over to our new friends area in the back. We have a gift for you, but more importantly, we just want to welcome you and let you know that we're glad that you're here. The rest of you, there's prayer requests and all these other good things on this card. When you're ready to get involved, go ahead, fill that out. You can put them in the boxes at the back of the room on your way out. One thing I'm excited for as we're jumping into the new year is we are back into our Matthew series that we've been going through for a little while. They have these Matthew journals out there at the info desk. If you haven't gotten one yet, I want to make sure that you guys leave this room after this, pick this up at the info desk. It's going to have notes for you. You're going to be able to follow along on what we're doing each and every week here. And if you're online, let your online host know. There's a chat box there. Let them know that you are in need of one of these Matthew journals. And there's also an online connection card you can fill out too. We just cannot wait to get this year going. So right now, you guys, we are going to stand back up and continue to worship.
Come on, stand to your feet. We're going to get into some more worship today. Anybody excited about Jesus this morning? Come on, this is second service. We should be up, right? Come on, let's sing this out right here. It says this. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. And when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. Come on, help me sing. Say, because the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never. Come on, y'all believe that. Sing it again right here. Say, my God will. Yeah. So let's say. So I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you. Come on, declare that over your ear today. Say, say I'm gonna see a victory. Yes, I will.
I'm gonna see a victory.
Yes, I will. Worship right here. For the battle belongs to you. It belongs to you. see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. God, you've never lost and you never will. Come on, give God praise for that. Jesus, we bless you that we have the victory in you. We can walk in authority because you've already won. Some miracles when you move. It's such an easy thing for you to do. And your hand is moving right now. And you were still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. And your voice is calling me out. And right now, see, I know you're able. And my God, see, come through again. See, you can do all. The battle, no, you never lost the battle, and I know you never will. We believe, yeah, we declare victory on today. Come on, let's sing this together. Sing, everything's possible,
everything's possible by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new taking over like it's miracle.
Sing and say, You can do all things but fail, 'cause you never lost the battle. No, you never lost the battle. And I know you never will. One more time, let's sing it out and say, see, you can do all things. You can do all things but fail. You never lost the battle. No, you never lost the battle. And I know you never will. Come on, can we praise the victorious God that we serve? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. You're so worthy, Jesus.
This morning we've been declaring these truths about who our God is, that He is merciful. Now we have an opportunity just to surrender before Him and tell Him, God, I'm available to You. So would You sing this with me?
Narrow as the road may seem, I'll follow where Your Spirit leads. Broken as my life may be, I will give You every
I am.
sacrifice. Use me how you want to, God. Have your throne within my heart.
All over this room this morning, let's pray. Holy Spirit, Heavenly Father, you are so good. You are so good and merciful. Thank you, God, that we can come boldly before you this morning, that we can surrender ourselves, God, that we can say, I'm available, Lord. I'm ready for those next steps that you're calling me into, God, that I want to say yes to you, Jesus. We just are so honored to be able to glorify and worship you. And all God's people said, amen, amen. You guys can have a seat.
Well, hey, Happy New Year. Good morning. If you're with us online, glad to have you. We are going to be doing communion in just a little bit at the end of the service. So you want to take some time, grab those elements for the rest of you guys in the room. We got you covered. We're going to take care of that. I said good morning, but it's really like night for me. It's 9:22 in the evening. My body says that to me right now. It was so great. I got to go. We had 47 people go with us to Israel on a pilgrimage. Yeah. We left on December 28th, and we got back yesterday morning at 6 in the morning after a 15-hour flight. Woo! So I've been up since 1:30. It's great. It's good. Man, I'm going to tell you what. Israel was amazing. I would love to take you. It is a faith changer, a game changer, literally just to stand and walk where Jesus walked, to be out on a lake, the Sea of Galilee, where he walked and he fished and he taught thousands of years, like literally the DNA, like from the beginning, to experience that in real life. Changes you and your faith. And I'm still unpacking it. I know my friends that came with me, we're going to be unpacking it for quite some time. And a lot of people have been asking me like, hey, you're going to do this again? The answer is yes. I can tell you ahead of time, we're going to be doing this again. I'm going to take another group in February of 25, the 12th to the 22nd. And if you're interested in coming or you just want information about it, this week I'll send out information about it. That gives you like 18 months to like 20 months to like save or to make payments and to get ready for that stuff. I'm gonna send stuff out this week. So there's a connection card in front of you. If you wanted to write like your name and your email and just say interested in Israel, I'll add you to that group and send you information about that. I'm gonna be unpacking stuff about it for the next years. We have been walking through a journey through the book of Matthew, a gospel, the first gospel in the New Testament. And like we got to experience that in real life. And so I'll be showing pictures as we go through that and give you some other context. But it was just a really beautiful experience that I can't quite put into words yet. And I'm excited for others to experience it for the first time and what it does truly to your faith. So if you're interested in that, would love to take you. But like I said, we have been going on a journey through the book of Matthew. If you're new with us, we got a journal. Vanessa mentioned this. We're on page 61. We wrote this kind of ahead of time to be a resource for you to take notes, also to follow up with community group questions and dig in a little bit deeper. You can get that out in the lobby afterwards, or if you have that, we're on page 61. And today we're wrapping up chapter 11 of Matthew. So congratulations. It's taken years to get here. We have a lot of years to go. Today we're gonna wrap up chapter 11. And some of you are like, I don't even remember what we were talking about the last time we talked about Matthew. So let me try to give you a really quick review of just this chapter, not all of it. You can go back and watch anytime you want. So in this chapter, what we saw is in the beginning, Jesus was teaching in their cities, his disciple cities, around this, the communities around the Sea of Galilee. And while he was teaching, John the Baptist, who's a figure that we've learned about, his disciples showed up and said, John wants to know if you are who you say you are. John was in a pickle, and it's a bad spot. He was doubting at the time, he was struggling. And Jesus said, go back and tell him what you hear, what you see. These things are happening, this is who I am. So they left, and then Jesus started like an epilogue of John. Talked about how he was the greatest human to be born amongst men. And then talked about how, look it, this was the greatest person, but still even in his greatness, it's not good enough. Still, you need a Messiah. Still, you need a Savior. Like, we need this. And then he explained, look it, John came and he gave you all truth, and you rejected it. I've shown up, and I'm given tons of grace. I'm hanging out with sinners and seeing them, and I have compassion for them. And that's not good enough for you. Then he starts to go on this tirade with like judgment deal, which was where we kind of ended. It was a super happy note where he talked about these woes to these different communities, some communities that we actually went in when we went to Israel, and talked about like, it's gonna be worse for these communities that I've gone into, and they've seen the works, they've seen the miracles, they've heard the message, they've been treated this way, and yet a transformation didn't happen to them. Like, life change didn't happen to them. And woe to them. It's better for these other communities who didn't even go into, or pagan communities, that on the day of judgment, it'll be better for them. So that's like where we ended. And you guys were all like, whoa, Merry Christmas, right? So we're gonna pick up. That kind of gives you the really fast forward. You can go back and read it. But we're gonna start today in verse 25 through 30. Just as a heads up, a lot of times we teach out of the NIV version. It's a translation of the Bible. Today I'm going to be teaching out of the ESV. So just if you're trying to figure out where I'm reading from. So it says, at that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is one of the most popular verses in Matthew, verse 28, and I'm gonna unpack the details of that in a few minutes, but this idea of like, come to me. There's this beautiful invitation for all of us who labor. And doesn't it feel like you've been laboring in life and wavering or burdened, you're burdened down, and he says, I will give you what? Rest. He says, I'm gonna give you rest. That everything else is gonna burden you down, but I'm gonna give you rest. I'm the one who can provide it. And there's this invitation to come and to get it. How? If you're in church for the first time, or you're new to church, or you're just exploring Christianity or spirituality, it's not through like rituals, like a lot of people think. It's not trying to show yourself to God how good you are and how many good things you can do and how you can attend church regularly or do a pilgrimage or, you know, go do a confession and say four Hail Marys and then, you know, show up more to Mass or whatever you can do to prove to God that you have real value and worth. And then you might like get to heaven, and which is kind of what we think about life. And that's not what the gospel's about. The idea is that like, man, you get to experience not religion, but a relationship with the God of the universe. This is what Paul actually talks about in Galatians. If you flipped over a couple books from Matthew, Paul asks this question. Talking to the Galatians, he's trying to figure that, who are trying to figure this thing out. Like, what does this look like? They're trying to figure out, how do I have a relationship with God versus just listening to laws and paying attention to religion? And he asks this very interesting question in Galatians 3, verse 2. He says this, let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law or by hearing with faith? He's saying, it's by religion. Is it by religion that you got to experience the power of the Spirit and transformation in your life? Is it that? Or is it faith in Jesus and what he's done, a relationship? And then what you have is this experience of the Spirit. And the deal is frankly, some of you, I don't know if you have that. Some of you sit here right now and like all you have is religion. Like all you have and you've just been like toiling, just like trying to do good things. And you haven't experienced the power of the Spirit relationally with the God of the universe. Yet Jesus is saying that this is how it's done. And the reason is some of you don't feel it because you haven't tested it. Like you haven't tried to really live on the edge of what God's trying to do in your life, so you don't feel it on a day-to-day basis. So the question really for this new year is, for all of us, is have you experienced the Spirit? Some of you are bored. You're bored with Christianity. You're bored with it. You're feeling like, oh, this is so boring. It's just same rhythm and routine. I'm just not experiencing anything during the week. I don't feel anything. Like, here's why. Because you haven't put yourself on the edge where if God doesn't show up, you're gonna fail miserably. You keep yourself safe in a comfortable place, which is why you don't experience the power of the Spirit working through you on a day-to-day basis. I've experienced this. I remember I was going through the process, my wife and I, through the process of international adoption. We had gone through a bunch of stuff, and it finally got to the point where, like, I felt like I had a bit of control, and so I took it. It was like, I need to figure out how to get him home. I got to do a travel visa and a transit visa in this country, and you can't go into this country, and this flight here and this timing here. And like, you had to work all these puzzle pieces, and for some reason, I could not make it work. I was at the end of myself. I was so frustrated because finally, like, I'm in control of this, and my friend smacked me upside the head. He's like, dude, what are you doing? Like, you are toiling and chasing after the wind right now. You are relying on yourself, and yourself ain't good enough in this process. Like, you didn't get invited into this thing in the first place because you were good enough. This was a whole different situation. And I ended up opening this up in Galatians 3:3, and it was like, you've been led by the Spirit this whole time, and now you're just trying to do this yourself. You got this all wrong. But if you put yourself where you have nothing, and then he shows up, he then does these amazing things in your life. Amazing things in your life. So if you're bored, start doing other things. Put yourself on the edge where you have nothing but him and see him show up. So verse 25, I thank you, Father. Now look at what he thanks him for. He says, at the time Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. So what Jesus thanks God for right here is like totally weird and upside down, if you're thinking about this. It's backwards, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding. So on this side, you have the wise and understanding, and on this side, you've revealed everything to little children, which is very backwards the way that we think. See, God functions vastly different than you and me. Like, we function in a way where we would never pray this, like, thanks for not revealing things to people, right? Like, thanks, Lord, for hiding the truth from that guy. Like, we would never pray this. We were way more simplistic. We're working on a totally different plane of reality than God's, where he's working on this higher plane. And so we tend to like pray for everyone, that everyone in this room has a great life. That's usually our prayer, that the truth is revealed to them, that everybody's healthy, everybody's happy, everybody has enough provision, that our marriages are good. I mean, think about your prayer requests in your community group, right? Like when you're sitting in community, what are you praying for? It's like somebody raises their hand, like, hey, can you pray for my foot? It hurts, right? Or this, or like, I need some more money, or like my kids, or like even all these positive and beautiful, awesome things. But we rarely go, hey, can we just pray for my boss that God would hide the truth from him? Like, I'm really struggling with this guy. Like, we just don't do that. We don't pray that prayer. So it's weird right here seeing Jesus like praying this prayer. But here's the point of him praying this. It's hyperbole. He's talking about an idea. And this idea that only the people who really come into the kingdom, that these are the only types of people who get into the kingdom. Here's the cultural critique for you and I for right now. See, what we do is we praise powerful people, good-looking people, successful people. Those are the people that like we gravitate towards and we let influence us and we champion. We say, look at these people. These are the people, and this is what it's all about. And Jesus says, thank you for making sure that these people don't get into the kingdom because they're trusting in their own power and their own ability and their own good looks. And thank you that you've revealed it to, what does he call it? Little children. Underline that, little children. It's fascinating, little children. Like, let's be offended. Like, let's be completely offended because everybody whose truth has been revealed to, he calls a child. So he flips this thing totally upside down. He says that the very people who in that culture are shluffed off to the side, the very people that we would look and say, oh my goodness, I'm not gonna follow you, are the very people that the truth has actually been revealed to. And his point is, and think about this, kids are what? Dependent, right? Kids, what do? They don't realize, how many of you guys got kids? Raise your hand if you've got a kid, okay? So there's a whole bunch of us got kids. You guys get this. Here's the point. They don't realize all the things that you do for them, right? They walk around like they own the place, right? They eat food like they earned it. Like, I showed up today, feed me. I slept, right? I put in a couple hours. I'm hungry, right? They drink water because they earned it, like all of those things. But here's the deal. This is exactly how we function with God as adults. We walk around like we own this place. We walk around like we get to eat because we earned it or drink water because we earned it. And God says, no, you drink water, you breathe air, and you eat because I decided it was my gracious will for you to wake up and give you those things today. And so people who humbly go, I need him. Those are the people that get into the kingdom. That's what he's saying. He's saying who recognizes themselves as a child, who go, I actually need God. I am dependent on God. That's the deal. Kids are dependent. They just are. They're humble sometimes after a little pushing. I know my kid, he comes out and there's a knot in his shoe and you're like, you need help? Nope, need help? Nope. And then finally it's like, help me, right? They get to that point. They're dependent and they're humble. And so they come into the kingdom. Some of you, some of us, friends, need to start acting like a child this year because you're trusting in your own wiseness, in your own wisdom, in your own limitedness of the, look how cool I am. Look how much money I have. Look at my social status. And you're just trusting all those things and you're not willing to become a little child. And the amazing thing is this, friends, that God will use little children, the messed up people in this room who haven't got it all together. And the great hope here is God will still use you. You don't have to be perfect. You can be a little child who's dependent, who's a mess, a disaster, a mistake-ridden person, and God will use you to do great things and speak great things. I am a testimony to that. Verse 27, he says, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal to him. So he stops right here and he does some like Christology here for a minute. He stops talking about us for a second and he starts talking about his relationship with God. And the beautiful thing about this is now he starts to pull back the veil and he starts to teach us about who God is, which is really important for you and me. We're gonna take a little deeper dive right here. So hang on with me for a second. Because most people have this really broad view of who God is. Everyone just like dumps all of their own meaning and concept into who God is and what he is. And Jesus comes along and he says, I've got this different construct of God. Jesus comes and says, I have this different construct of God that I now want to pitch to you. And the pitch is that there is a Father, there's a Son, and then later he's going to talk about a Spirit, right? See, so Christianity has a Trinitarian view of God, where there's a Father, a Son, and a Holy Spirit, eternally one, eternally distinct, which is this beautiful concept of God for a few reasons. So back in the philosophical days, Aristotle, Socrates, all the big philosophers, they talked about the philosophy of how do we find unity amidst diversity in the universe? Like the universe is this one giant big thing, but in the midst of that big thing, there's diversity. In a way, like, why is this room in one way, unity, we're all here, because we're all together, and in the midst of that unity, there's diversity, there's individual people. And every other version of God can't really capture that reality emanates from the first. You see, a strict monotheism, a Unitarian monotheism of Judaism or Islam doesn't allow for any plurality in God. And so there's just unity. In the polytheism of like a Hinduism, there's only plurality and then there's no unity. So Christianity comes along and says there is one God and that one God is made up of three persons. And even though the Trinity is something that is ultimately beyond our intellectual understanding, the Trinity life is there for us to experience. God the Father is the one we pray to. God the Holy Spirit is the thing inside of us, comforting us, caring for us, urging us to pray. And God the Son is the bridge or the road along which we are pushed to that goal. It is quite simply experiential. And the early Christians, after the resurrection of Christ and the experience of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, found themselves caught up in this new phenomenon. And it took them time to articulate in theological terms just exactly what they were experiencing. In so many ways of trying to explain this, it still doesn't encompass all of the roles of God. Now, you've heard it said before, like, yeah, it's like a three-headed monster, right? Or it's like an egg with a shell and a yolk and a white. Or it's like water that's steam, and then it's water and then it's ice. Or like myself, I'm a son, I'm a father, and I'm a husband. It's one, but it's multiple. And then we get confused, and then we don't really know where to go with it. But I think there's this beautiful, practical point. There's Trinity. There's community. It's why you love community. It's why you love people. It's why there can be diversity in the midst of plurality. And it's, so this is what Jesus is saying, that there is a Father, a Son, and there is a Spirit. Now, you and I might be okay with that, but here's the scandal of this, what he just said in this verse. Nobody else, anywhere you go, believes this. No one believes this anywhere you go. What he just said here is absolutely scandalous, that there is one God. This is what everybody else thinks, and I die for it. That's what Judaism says. That's what the newer religion of Islam says, that I die for that doctrine. And here I come along, three persons, one guy, and it's like, wait, what? The next thing he says is an absolute scandal. He says this, no one knows the Father except the Son and anyone whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Want to know what the scandal is? Every religion in the world thinks that they know the Father, thinks that they know God, and Jesus just said, you don't know God unless you know me. This is the exclusivity of Christianity in a nutshell. That you don't know God the Father, you don't know him unless you know the Son, unless the Son chooses to reveal the Father to you. That you don't know God. That's the most scandalous part about Christianity, period, in our culture and in their culture, period. And Jesus came to create this new era, this new epoch, a new way of actually connecting with the God of the universe, which is something some of you have never even heard before. And so we're going to see. He says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. First off, I think we need to understand what a yoke is because it sounds opposite to what it is. It sounds like Jesus is literally adding something to us. He says, like, take my yoke. And we're kind of like, well, we're busy. Like, we're already feeling pretty heavy in life. I don't need Jesus to add something else to us. And it doesn't really make sense that he's going to hand us a yoke and handing us something is somehow going to make us lighter. Where he says, I'm going to put a yoke on you. And now we would say, like, what is that? Most of us didn't grow up in an agrarian society. So let me explain to you what a yoke is. It's a big, giant wooden thing that I don't have a picture of, but I'm going to explain it to you. So you've probably seen it in oxen before. It looks kind of like this. It has an arm that goes around one oxen, and it comes around their neck, and then another one around another oxen, and it levels them out. And a craftsman comes and actually makes it based on the size of the ox or the bull and their shoulders, because some of them are bigger and broader, and some of them are smaller. And this is what then controls them, so they carry, and it helps distribute the weight. So that way, one doesn't pull too far ahead and the other one gets lagged behind, but they both get to level off until your line is straighter. The weight is distributed, and the heavier load goes onto the more mature, stronger ox, right? So here's what Jesus is saying. Take my yoke. I'm already in the yoke. I'm already in this yoke. Hop in here with me. And so you can come with me and I'm going to teach you that I'm going to be the more mature oxen, that you can get connected to me and then the line will be straighter and the burden that you've been bearing in life will actually be lightened because I have the broader shoulders. That's the idea, that I'm going to take the wrath of God for you, that I'm going to take the weight. And some of you, you know, you feel burdened and we feel this sense of needing some rest at some level. And even those of us who, like in secular terminology, this is what Stephen Covey talks about. He says that we all have a true north. We all have like this center point of our humanness where we're all trying to find rest in something. We're all trying to find meaning in life, our identity in life. And some of you are like, I don't really have a yoke. I don't really have anything that I've attached myself to. But the reality is every single one of us, we have something that we're trying to find meaning and rest and purpose and joy. And Stephen Covey, he writes down a list of ideas that you have a true north. And for some of you, it's like your sexual life. And that's how you find rest and joy. And your identity is built around that. And for others, it's money. And others, it's power. And others, it's marriage. Notice I didn't say kids, because you may find joy, but you will not find rest. Whatever it is, we find ourselves in a scenario where we're all searching, where we're all like trying to yoke ourselves to something. And even if you think that you haven't, you have. All of us have a worldview, a religion, an ideology, a yoke of something that we've banked everything on. It might be secularism, that there's no God, that we're supposed to just run society without religion. It might be the yoke that you've tied yourself to. It might be power or money or whatever. But know that every one of those, if it is not Jesus, it's just going to create more weight and restlessness. So I talk to people with a lot of money. It's like the song goes, mo money, mo problems, right? It's like you just try to get money, but there's always more money to get. It's this endless, restless, get more and more and get more. For some of you, if you talk to somebody with power, you got to get more power. Even a job, there's always something else to do. Even in the pursuit of good things, we don't have rest. We don't have the satisfaction that Jesus actually provides. And this is what happens. I remember a question from a teenager that I once got. Like, how do I know that I'm a follower of Jesus? Like, how do I know that I'm a Christian? Like, how do I actually know? Is there affirmation? Or because I wonder sometimes. And one of the things that came to me, this whole idea in John 4, where he says, if you drink the water I give you, you will never thirst again. Then John 6, he says, if you eat the bread that I provide you, you will never be hungry again. And the question is, listen, are you satisfied? Is there contentment in your life with Jesus? Or are you continuously restless, burdened down with more? And I want more of this and shinier things and more money, more power, better this, better that, more influence. And Jesus says, if you drink what I give you, if you eat what I give you, there's going to be a satisfaction in me where the things of this world aren't going to satisfy you anymore. And that's part of the indicator that you actually know him, that you're not actually going out all of the time trying to pursue more and more with no satisfaction in your life. That's the kind of rest that he's talking about. So here's the question for you. Assess your life right now as you sit here. Have you eaten? Have you drank of the water that Jesus gives? Have you eaten the bread that he gives you? Or is there always more and more in pursuit? There's never contentment. There's never satisfaction. So he offers this beautiful, honest, wonderful rest that's in him. Parts of the last 12 months, it feels like I've barely had enough time to catch my breath. It's impacted my sleep at times, my physical and mental health, and I'm sure I'm not alone. I think this sums up life in our modern world. We're constantly running around, chasing the goal that's always moving. Am I right? I think most of us need a break from the tide of work, stress, fear, chaos, anxiety that 2022 has thrown at us. But I know that during the holidays that we just had, rest can be especially elusive because while you may have had time off of work, many of us have forgotten how to hit the pause button in our lives. I think it's interesting that the Hebrew word we translate as busy in the Bible is asah, which means to do. See, friends, God didn't create us as human doings, but as human beings. And sometimes we just need to stop doing and just be. We have to remember what my friend Bob Goff says. He says, darkness wants us to live our lives worn out. Rest is holy. Get some. So while the world right now, maybe you right now, is gearing up for what this next year ahead looks like, perhaps the thing that will help you right now is not planning how you will work, budget, and exercise, but planning how you will stop, breathe, and rest. Are you ready to do that? Come to me, all who are labor, heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. We're going to have a meal together, communion, and as we prepare ourselves for that, in a few moments, we're going to sing a response song. And you're going to have an opportunity to get up with loved ones and take the cup and take the bread. Pastor Jim, our seniors pastor, led communion for our staff this morning. And I love the version he read from 1 Corinthians 11. He read from the Message version. 1 Corinthians 11, 24 says this, "Let me go over with you again exactly what goes on in the Lord's Supper and why it is so centrally important. I have received my instructions from the Master himself and passed them on to you. The Master, Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, took bread. Having given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body broken for you. Do this and remember me.' After supper, he did the same thing with the cup. 'This cup is my blood, a new covenant with you. Each time you drink this cup, remember me.' What you must solemnly realize is that every time you eat this bread and every time you drink this cup, you reenact in your words and actions the death of the Master. You will be drawn back to this meal again and again until the Master returns. You must never let familiarity breed contempt. Anyone who eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Master irreverently is like part of the crowd that jeered and spit on him at his death. Is that the kind of remembrance you want to be a part of? Examine your motives, test your heart, come to this meal in holy awe. So, my friends, when you come together to the Lord's table, be reverent and courteous with one another. It is a spiritual meal, a love feast." In just a few moments, we're going to have an opportunity to partake. And maybe you're here for the first time and you're not sure if you should partake in this. This is, no one's judging you. No one's watching who's getting up. You can go by yourself. You can go with a family member or a whole group of people. You can go and take it. There's a cup of juice and just underneath it is bread, gluten-free bread, just so you know. But we're going to have a moment where we get to pause and remember and reflect and prepare our hearts before we come to that table, just like you said. Our theme throughout our time in Israel was we got to go and see that he came. And then we went to Calvary and saw an empty tomb, and we learned why he came. And so the bread is a remembrance that he came, his body. And the cup, this new covenant, is remembering why he came. And so may you pause, reflect, come to him who are heavy burdened, and remember why he came for you. I'm gonna pray, and then we're gonna spend about a minute just in silence before you go to the table. When the music starts, you're then invited to get up and grab your communion and then take it on your own in your own time as we respond in worship. Would you pray with me? Father God, your children are here. God, may we just sit in your presence as children, dependent on you. Eager for the kingdom, eager for the rest that you give, the lightness of your yoke. God, thank you for the gift of your Son. Thank you that we get to celebrate that you came and why you came. God, may your Spirit move in this place and meet us right where we are. That your Spirit would give comfort, faith, courage, peace, joy, gentleness. We love you. In your precious Son's name we pray. Amen.
in this moment, you can stand on your feet and go and take of the elements. We got tables on every side. You don't have to wait on us. You can go ahead and take it. And after you take it, you can join us in worship as we do this last song. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the oceans. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
You are a healer, 'cause you today and forevermore. Grateful for your faithfulness to us. Nobody like you, Lord. Nobody like you, Lord. You freed the captives, then you're freeing hearts right now. 'Cause you are the same God. You are the same God. You touch the lepers, and I feel your touch right now. 'Cause you are the same God. You are the same God. You're the same, oh, yes, you are, yeah. Grateful for you, Lord. Grateful for your consistency. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. As I'm calling on the Holy Spirit, Almighty River, come and fill me. Come on, let's sing that to him. Say, come and fill me. One more time, say, just come and fill me again. Come on, give God praise. Thank you, Jesus.
As I was singing that song and as I was listening to Pastor Larry teach, there's this phrase that just kept running over and over in my head. And I think it's a different version of the same passage that Larry taught out of. And it asked this question at the start. And so I felt like it was a fitting way to end tonight is to just ask you the same question. It says it like this in Matthew 11:28. It says, are you tired? Are you worn out? Burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Right? God offers that to you and to us. What a gift. What a gift. And I think for us, we believe that for everyone in this room, that we have a next step that we can take in our faith. And for some of you, that next step may actually be a first step. It may be you saying yes to Jesus for the first time, saying, I'm tired. I'm done with religion. I want a relationship. We would love to be a part of that process for you. It's exciting. It's exhilarating. It's also scary. So that's why a while ago, Pastor Leah wrote a 21-day journal, a journey. It's called This Changes Everything. You may hear us say TCE around here. But if you go out in the lobby, we've got the TCE area, This Changes Everything. And basically what this is, it breaks it down into two things. One is it talks about the nature and the character of who God is. And then here's the other part is it doesn't just talk about who God is. It talks about what God thinks about you. And I think it'd be fair to say there's so many times when we look at Scripture and we go, I know God loves me, but God likes me too. And he wants to be with me. He wants to rest with me. And so that's the invitation. And if we could, we would love to be able to give this to you as a first step in your relationship with God. And then again, for all of us, is that we've got that next step. I think it's one of the things that I love about our church is that we have next steps. That we in fact, if you've been around Northgate at all, then you know that we hold to these three values: celebration, inspiration, and the next steps. It's why we come up here and we sing and we have a big old party. It's why we get to listen to fantastic teachings and that when we look to God's word and saying, how will we be inspired and changed? And then we talk about all these different next steps. And so I was really excited today because I not only got to talk about that, but I get to do that in our generous living, which we get to talk about right now. Absolutely. And this one's fun, and I'll tell you why. Over Christmas, There was an organization that we told some stories about and that we were supporting. It's an organization called SOS, which it stands for Solano Options and Support. And here's the fun thing. So Solano's Options and Support is the organization that we invited you to generously give to. And let me tell you this. First off, the celebration is this. We gave over the Christmas season, and just as we're supporting SOS, we gave $7,703.97. Absolutely. And so that's a celebration because of your generosity is that you're supporting this organization. Now, here's the inspiration. Let me tell you what they do. Is that after we were done doing some of the filming and telling the stories, is we got one more story out of them. And they said, because of your generosity, because of your $7,703.97, that there was this young lady, 16 years old, completely addicted to drugs, and spending her life going out to get more drugs in any sort of way that she could. She ran out of options. She was out of options. She didn't know what to do. Addicted to drugs. Her life was an absolute mess. And she went to her school. Her school didn't know what to do. So they reached out to SOS. And because of your generosity is that they're helping to get her and other people like that off of drugs and back into a lifestyle where they are not only following Jesus, but making the right life choices for them. And that's because of your generosity. And then, absolutely. And then here's the third part, celebration, inspiration, and the next steps. I could tell you for the next 30 minutes, but I'm not going to, about all of the organizations that you support. Over the Thanksgiving season, we talked about the 22 missional organizations that because of your generosity, you give to. I could tell you about our student ministries going to winter camp in the next month. I could tell you about our families and our children's ministry doing an evening event at the end of January. I could tell you about our divorce care, our grief share. I could tell you about all those different things. And each one of those happened because you stepped forward and you said yes. Because you generously give. And so your money fuels and funds that sort of a thing that happens not just here, but in our community around. And so we invite you to continue to do that. Or maybe it is that this is the year that you go, I'm going to step in and I want to do that. And you can give online or through the app. We have a Venmo. You can give in the boxes in the back. But we just invite you to know that not a single dollar of your money is wasted, including 97 cents. Every bit of it. God sees it all. And he uses it for his glory and allowing his name to be spread. So we invite you to do that today. And then beyond that, I would love to just send you out with a blessing. So I invite you in a sign of receiving to put your hands out. And that may we, as people in this new year, that we don't see stepping into rest as one more thing to do. In fact, it's less. God, could we give you our burden, trusting that as a good God, that is where we fully get to step in to you. My friends, go in peace, in rest, and in a new year. God bless you. See you soon.